Years ago, when I was at Oxford, I belonged to a college literary and discussion society, which, according to S.P.B. Mace, was one of the last to carry on the traditions of the 1890s, with elaborate regalia for its officers and elaborate minutes listing the attendance of all on or honourable members and on officials. The minutes reveal that in the late 1950s, the society came across a medieval ritual for raising the devil and promptly tried it out. The minutes record that the on the devil did not attend, but the escapade was reported in the local papers and produced an anxious letter from a rural gentleman who declared himself to be a white witch and warned that the Davenant Society of Lincoln College was running horrifying risks. The society immediately elected him on witch to the society and invited him to come and read a paper on his beliefs, which he did. In those days, he was a pretty lone eccentric. Today, more and more people, feeling discontented with traditional modes of worship, are declaring themselves to be pagans and worshipping nature witchily in the countryside. Or they have failed to understand why no serious scholars have ever accepted Margaret Murray's theory that medieval witch trials exposed an imaginary ancient religion that can be revived. Or, in some more sinister cases, they actually declare themselves to be devil worshippers and desecrate churches and graveyards. Can this last group actually raise the devil? Some of those who have studied Sean Sellers believe that they can and do. At 2 a.m. on September the 8th, 1985, a young man was driving two nurses home from a dance in Oklahoma City. They came to a Circle K filling station and went into its convenience shop for the key to the washroom. There was no sign of any attendant. And then one of the nurses saw blood trailing across the shop floor, splashed in little drops around the room, indicating to a trained eye that a frenzied, bleeding man had raced desperately here and there, trying to escape from an attacker. But failing. For in the back of the shop, 36-year-old Robert Bowers lay dead. His thick, bushy beard was matted with blood. His dirty cowboy boots pointed mutely to the ceiling. The natural first impression the police formed was that this was armed robbery, a midnight hold-up with a Saturday night special, turning casually into murder when the night clerk refused to cooperate or made some sudden, startling movement. This very reasonable notion did not survive examination of the shop and the body. There was nothing missing from the till, and Bauer's wallet, still holding $90, remained in his pocket. A girlfriend assured police that Bowers was fundamentally a devout coward who would never resist robbers. Had he been killed by some personal enemy, then? Nothing detectives could learn supported the idea. Bowers was pretty much of a loser. Separated from a wife in Texas, he had been stranded in Oklahoma City for a year after running out of money on his way to visit her. The night store attendant's job paid very little, and whatever he earned over and above subsistence was quickly spent on drugs. He changed girlfriends often and rapidly, greatly fancying himself as a ladies' man, but usually shown the door after sponging or making too free with their possessions. And similar quarrels always broke up living arrangements with men roommates. One, indeed, had recently stormed out, vowing to kill the skinny and morose Bowers. But investigation proved that this man had been asleep in bed 100 miles away that night. No. The shooting of Robert Paul Bowers with a heavy silver-grain-tipped bullet from a .387 Magnum pistol seemed destined to remain a mystery. Possibly an impromptu thrill killing. 6 months later, investigating another incident, police collected an unexpected confession which wrapped up the Circle K murder. On September the 5th, 1986, officers were called to the suburban home of Lee and Vonda Bonifato. Vonda's 17-year-old son, Sean, had come home in the morning after a night spent at the suburb of Piedmont with his friend Jim Mathis and Jim's 15-year-old wife, Sandy. As he would be late for school, Sean was looking for a note from his mother to give to the teacher. When he went into the house, He found the doorstop of a sliding door kicked away and the door open. In their bedroom, his mother and stepfather lay still on their king-size waterbed. Shot with 4-4 bullets. A rifle draw indicated that they had been the victims of a housebreaker. But this time, the police were in no doubt about the status of the crime. The housebreaking had obviously been faked. The opened sliding door could not have been forced from the outside. Its stop had been pulled away from inside the room. The emptied drawer was the only sign of robbery. Nothing had actually been stolen. This was an inside job disguised as a break-in. And the only possible insider was Sean, the cherubic-faced teenager with shoulder-length blonde hair. At this point, the police did not connect this theftless theft with that at the Circle K 6 months earlier. They were too interested in Sean's alternation between impassioned outbursts of grief for his dead parents and the cold, detached, unemotional way in which he accounted for his own time spent over at the Mathises the previous night. Inquiries at Sean's school turned up some deviations from a calm and respectable norm, however. 2 days earlier, his English teacher had been deeply shocked by an essay the lad wrote, in which he declared himself to be a worshipper of Satan, and one who was quite willing to go the distance of human sacrifice in order to make evil his good. The teacher passed the essay on to the school principal, who in turn informed Sean's mother, Vonda. She had been writing her only son a long, sympathetic letter to try and help him sort out his problems on the day before she was killed. The school did not raise another worrying issue with Sean's parents. It was rumoured that he had boasted of his responsibility for the mysterious Circle K murder. But this might so easily be adolescent fantasy, magnified by playground gossip, that the teachers did not take it seriously as fact, though naturally they worried about the impact of such fantasies on the moral climate of the school. A search of Sean's bedroom in the Bonifato house suggested that some sort of Satanism was going on. He owned a copy of Anton Chandler LaVey's Satanic Bible. One corner of his room was turned into a rather sinister little shrine, with black candles, a sword, and dagger, and a chalice from which Sean drank his own blood, kept in the refrigerator. But on a more rational level, there was evidence that Sean had direct reasons for quarrelling with his parents. They disapproved of his new girlfriend. They had quite a track record for disapproving of his girlfriends, but Angel, as far as they were concerned, was the pits. To them, she seemed little better than a gypsy, emphatically from the wrong side of the tracks. To Sean, she represented total love and desire. The Bonifatters were not really snobs. They were a respectable, rather moderate Catholic working-class couple. They team-drove as long-distance truckers, and their marriage was immensely happy and successful. Moreover, Lee Bonifato adored his wife's son, and Sean had long accepted Lee as an ideal father figure. There seems to have been a touch of possessiveness in their repeated fears that Sean's adolescent infatuations took him away from them. But there was no doubt that they genuinely thought Angel was potentially bad company for the boy. Sean had apparently told his friends that his parents deserved to die. But now they were dead, he simply stuck to his story. The police found no murder weapon and no physical evidence positively linking Sean to the crime. He quietly, politely, and firmly refused to go and live with his grandparents or his aunt, who all hurried to Oklahoma City to rescue him. Instead, he moved into Angel's house and, with her mother's approval, Angel's bed. For one night only. The following day, Jim Mathis cracked. Pulled in by the police for further questioning, he admitted that Sean had not come to Piedmont till the small hours of the morning. He had come in a state of great excitement, carrying the gun with which he had killed his parents wrapped in a towel. Jim had agreed to dispose of it for him and threw it in his grandfather's garbage. The police recovered it immediately. And Jim confessed, too, that Sean had committed the Circle K murder. He had been with him at the time, though he said he stayed outside in the car while Sean went in, quarrelled with Bowers, and shot him. The boys had never liked the surly night attendant, who refused to sell them beer as they were underage, and made sly, suggestive remarks, when Sandy Mathis went in to buy tampons. Neither Sandy nor Angel had any idea that Sean had murdered Bowers and the Bonifatos, or that Jim was accessory to these crimes. Sean was quite intelligent enough to offer no silly evasive denial when he was arrested and told that Jim had talked. But his defence surprised even hardened policemen. He, Sean, hadn't been the real murderer, he said. Inside him, a demon called Ezeratu had taken possession of him and carried out the abominable snayings. They gave Ezeratu so much gratification that he filled Sean's ears with his contented growling as the victims died. And as one would expect of a devil, he had fled as soon as Sean was exposed. No longer possessed, Sean could explain exactly how it had all happened, how he had killed Lee and Vonda as a blood sacrifice demanded by Ezeratu, carrying out a ritual with satanic prayers in his bedroom first, and donning his black Satanist's gown, only to remove it when he feared its rustling might wake Lee. So he'd carried out the murder in his diabolical black underwear. He had come to Satanism via the fantasy game Dungeons and Dragons. He'd mixed with adolescent Satanists in the various towns where Lee and Vonda's peripatetic lifestyle as truck drivers had repeatedly exiled him to spend odd years with relatives. Oh, there were a good many high school Satanists across the west of the USA. They recognized each other by the devil's mark. They grew their left little fingernails long, filed them sharp, and lacquered them black. Then they drew more attention to the mark by wearing their left shirt sleeves rolled up. The police thought this was bunkum. Whatever nasty games he might play in his bedroom and with his little friends, he was just a typical teenage killer for them, callously shooting anyone who got in the way of his own choice of a good time. The jury agreed with the police. And do I think that the On the Devil, or his subsidiary, really did make a personal appearance on this occasion? No, I don't. High school Satanism offers its devotees exactly the same satisfaction as the adult version, an exotic setting to prevent participants from becoming jaded with sex and drugs orgies. By becoming a child Satanist, Sean had been able to enjoy a good deal of sexual activity from his early teens, and he'd been active in the use of drugs. But unlike most of his teenage fellow Satanists, who dropped out of the cult as more adult interests like getting into college or preparing for marriage took over, Sean was blessed or cursed with a religiose and hysterical temperament. When he said he worshipped, he worshipped. When he spoke of spiritual entities, he imagined he could hear them and their voices. He had, in fact, been hearing imaginary voices in his head ever since he was a perfectly good and happy little boy. His voices simply adapted to his new mind games. No. The On the Devil does not need to intrude on his worshippers with his presence. Anyone who seriously says, "Evil, be thou my good," has already done the devil's work on himself. He doesn't need to be bribed with any magical powers or astral travel or visions of demons, or the promptings of their supernatural voices.